morning and welcome to the Abundant Table service. I invite you to stand in body or spirit and let us sing together, all creatures of our God and King.
Unexpected ways and places. May we daily perceive the joy and wonder of your abiding presence and offer our lives in gratitude for our redemption. Almighty and everlasting God, you govern all things, both in heaven and on earth. Mercifully hear the supplications of your people, and in our time grant us your peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated.
A reading from Deuteronomy. Moses said, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your own people. You shall heed such a prophet. This is what you requested of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly when you said, 'If I hear the voice of the Lord God anymore or ever again see this great fire, I will die.' Then the Lord replied to me, 'They are right in what they have said. I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their own people. I will put my words in the mouth of the prophet, who shall speak to them everything that I command. Anyone who does not heed the words that the prophet shall speak in my name, I myself will hold accountable. But any prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, or who presumes to speak in my name a word that I have not commanded the prophet to speak, that prophet shall die.'" Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read responsively from Psalm 111, breaking at the asterisk. Hallelujah! I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. Great are the deeds of the Lord. His work is full of majesty and splendor. He makes his marvelous works to be remembered. He gives food to those who fear him.
He is ever mindful of his covenant.
He has shown his people the power of his works,
giving them the lands of the nations.
The works of his hand are faithfulness and justice.
All his commands are true.
They stand fast forever and ever.
Because they are done with truth and
equity. He sent redemption to his people. He commanded his covenant forever.
Holy and awesome is his name.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
Those who act accordingly have good understanding. His praise endures
Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus and his disciples went into Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." and the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once, his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I speak to you in the name of the living God, Blessed Trinity. Souls. Amen. You may be seated. I still remember the day my four-year-old sister, beaming with pride, showed me for the first time that she could write her name all by herself. My sister's palette was an assorted selection of semi-sharp rocks, hand-picked from the gravel driveway, and her makeshift canvas was the passenger side of my dad's red pickup truck, on which she etched her name forever into my family's history. As I took in this innocent moment, a look of mild horror remained on my face while my parents approached the scene. Though they praised her for her straight-lined consonants and well-rounded vowels, it didn't take long for my sister to realize she should have stuck to crayon on paper. Sam, can I turn this off? Can you all still hear me, or is that, it's not on the mic? Okay, let me switch this out. Should I switch that out, Sam?
Here.
There's another one, there's another pad. I guess so. Yeah. Thank you.
Mine's off.
Yours is off? Okay.
Off.
Check, check. Can you hear me on this? Okay. I'm gonna talk with my hands, so we'll try to make this work. So, my sister should have stuck to crayons on paper, and my father is rummaging through the garage for some imaginary tool to fix a hopeless situation, while my mother's holding my sister in her arms and says, "We're not blaming you." "Speak for yourself," came the swift retort from my father through the din of slammed drawers and clanging tins. "Speak for yourself." It's a colloquial phrase made popular in the early 18th century, but still used by fathers everywhere today. We say this when someone has the audacity to speak on our behalf without checking in with us as to whether we agree with their assessment. "Speak for yourself" is meant to convey a difference of opinion. But embedded within it is also an unintentional encouragement to, in fact, speak for yourself, to own your perspective rather than somebody else's. Research in linguistics and communications tells us that an I statement assumes responsibility for your thoughts, your feelings, your experiences, whereas we language assumes the sharing of responsibility. In today's gospel, Jesus speaks for himself. He takes responsibility for what he says while he's teaching in the synagogue. And this is an alarming experience for those listening to him, because they're used to the rabbinic royal we. You see, embedded within rabbinic tradition is the assumption that authority to teach God's law comes through a line of succession from your teacher and their teacher before them, passed on to you. So an authoritative teacher can trace their line of succession all the way back to Moses, the first person to receive God's law. According to Jewish Mishnah, Moses received the Torah from Sinai and transmitted it to Joshua, Joshua to the elders to the prophets transmitted it to the men of the great assembly, and this is why the Israelites were to listen to the wisdom of the sages and the scribes. because they are all part of a direct line of teachers dating back to the moment Moses said it first. Authority to teach Jewish law comes through the line of succession. When a teacher claims to know the meaning of God's law, they're ultimately claiming that what they say is true because Moses heard it first at Sinai. The trouble we run to in today's gospel is that Jesus doesn't claim the authority of Moses. Jesus speaks with his own authority. His teaching about the scriptures are his own ideas rather than those of former teachers. In fact, Jesus has this habit in the Gospels of quoting someone else's thoughts only if he's about to disagree with what they have to say. Listen to these words from Jesus' Sermon on the Mount in the Gospel of Matthew. "You have heard it said, 'You shall not murder.' But I tell you, being angry with someone is just as bad as murdering them. You have heard it said, 'Love your neighbor and hate your enemy.' But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. You have heard it said from the prophets and the sages, even Moses himself. They've told you one thing, but I tell you something different." The audacity of Jesus to assume that he could just speak for himself shocked the learned crowds. It worried the religious teachers, and it confounded the traditionalists who say, "This isn't how we do it." Today's gospel tells us that the crowds were murmuring to one another with an amazement that bordered on terror. "What is this new teaching with authority?" they asked each other. And while their confusion and their concerns mount, a man with an unclean spirit enters the synagogue and interrupts Jesus' teaching. So let's talk about what it means to be unclean for a minute. The word in this particular passage for unclean literally means mixed up in Greek. You may recall in the book of Leviticus that mixed things are not kosher. Clothing must be of one kind of thread. Certain foods must be prepared separate from other food. Mixing can make things and the people who interact with them unclean. This man's spirit was mixed with something other than the spirit everyone else seemed to have. There was an unknown element, something otherly, not yet understood, something that made his way of being different than most other people. The irony of the situation is that the mixed up man is the only one in the room who isn't confused about where Jesus' new teaching with authority is coming from. "I know who you are," he says to Jesus, "the Holy One of God." So now let's talk about the Holy One. This is a phrase we see all over the Old Testament. It's used to describe God, as well as individuals whom God anoints and sets apart to do God's will. The term is used to describe priests, kings, prophets, even Moses himself. The title is given only to those who speak the direct words of God, the ones that God gives them to speak, those who only do what God says to do. The Holy One is like a living, breathing, walking, talking Bible. God's teaching written on the heart of the person rather than on paper. We see this tradition of the Holy One represented in today's Old Testament reading. If you Bible nerds want to turn, it's the one from Deuteronomy. God says to Moses, "I will raise up a prophet like you from among the Israelites, and I will put my words in his mouth. He will tell them everything that I command." Moses foretold that there would be others like him who would receive this direct revelation from God, rather than a revelation that was handed down through the line of succession. Jesus' way of being a rabbi was so concerning because he acted like a holy one of God. And that's not something a legitimate rabbi had really done before. So Jesus' conundrum today is that this mixed up man recognizes
his Holy One status before the crowds have a chance to understand it for themselves. So Jesus tells the man to quiet down. He wants people to think for themselves just as much as he wants them to speak for themselves. And then whatever part of this man's spirit that was improperly mixed, Jesus draws out of him. And this act seems to do three things. First, it heals the man and brings him back into community. Second, it solidifies Jesus' authority. The crowds can't claim Jesus is simply a smooth talker. This act is proof that God's power is flowing through him. The laws of the universe do this rabbi's bidding. Someone's life was just radically transformed before their eyes simply because Jesus told it to. And thirdly, Jesus' act shows us that speaking for yourself doesn't just convey authority, it also comes with responsibility. This story ends by telling us that this act made the news of Jesus spread across the entire region. Others who needed healing began to hear that Jesus can create in us a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us. This was King David's ancient prayer. He was praying to God, and now Jesus is fulfilling it. This story is from the Gospel of Mark. We're in chapter 1. This is the oldest gospel, and the very first moment Jesus heals a person publicly. The headlines in the paper the next day all read, Jesus calls out the mixed up spirit and makes it clean and right again. This is why people began to flock to Jesus in ancient Palestine. And I wonder, isn't it still why we flock to Jesus today? You and I are here today because we hope Jesus will do for us what he did for that man in the synagogue. All of us struggle in some way with mixed up spirits. Like him, we hold within us the ideas and perspectives and expectations of too many others. There are opinions within us that don't come from within us, and they definitely don't come from God. If Jesus' teaching with authority tells us something, it's that we can far too often seek affirmation and approval from the wrong sources. We look to others to determine how we should live our lives. But Jesus knew that legitimization to be who God calls you to be doesn't come from human succession. According to his teachings, we are not just children of Moses or Abraham. We are ultimately all children of God. Perhaps Moses' foretelling that God would raise up the holy ones is not just about Jesus, but about Jesus' followers too. Jesus begins his ministry by teaching people how to think for themselves, how to speak for themselves, and eventually how to pray for themselves. What we call the Our Father, with its invitation to pray, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done," just might be Jesus' way of transforming our mixed up spirits into holy ones. So, we've come here today to learn from Jesus' ministry. And today, he can quiet your mixed up spirit, draw out the voices within it that do not belong to you or to God, help you to think for yourself and speak for yourself and pray for yourself so that God's teaching can be written on your heart rather than just on paper. And you too can become a living, breathing, walking, talking Holy One of God.
In the darkness before creation, you made all that lives and breathes. In the darkness of Mary's womb, you formed Jesus, bringer of light. In the darkness of our world, your spirit sustains us. O God,
you are with us in darkness and in light.
Under the cover of darkness, Magi followed the star to the Christ child. We come from the east and we come from the west, following you on our different roads, following the same star to the same place. O God,
you are with us in darkness and in light.
In the stillness of the dark, we pray for all who needs God's presence in a special way. People who cannot find work, who cannot pay their bills, who have no place to live, people who are discouraged and hopeless, people who have become cynical and bitter. O God, we live in this world in our bodies. We rejoice in life and breath. Yet when sickness or pain cripples us, we lose our bearings. We feel lost and bewildered. We need your presence to keep us safe. Be with those who have asked for our prayers, especially Barbara, Marianne, Tom, Sandy, Dawn, Roland, Lori, Deborah, Jim, Nancy, Tim, David, Tanya, Karen, Stuart, Edom, Bill, and Linda. We pray for loved ones who have died and for their families, especially Francis Custer. We pray for U.S. military personnel and for their families. We pray for our companions in the Diocese of Belize and the Diocese of Tanga, Tanzania. In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for St. Timothy's Church, Massillon, Trinity Church, New Philadelphia, Church of Our Savior, Salem, and New Life Episcopal Church, Uniontown. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the churches in the Diocese of Calabar, Nigeria. We continue to pray for the health of our presiding bishop, Michael B. Curry. We pray for the people of Israel and Gaza, for an end to violence, and for the vision to seek a new era of peace. We pray for all our worship, art, and music mission team, as they can create opportunities for transcendental encounters with God through liturgy, art, and music. We offer blessings upon those celebrating birthdays this week: Susan Bunner, Mimi Hendricks, Matthew Jarosik, Steve Johnson, Mike Moros, Charlotte Nichols, Piggy Price, Rick Schutz, and Sinya Gozo. O God,
with us in darkness and in light.
Thank you for moments of inspiration, for moments of clear vision when we see who we are and who we are meant to be, where we see where we are and what you want us and where you want us to go. Give us courage to take the journey that you call us to, and give us strength on the road. O God,
you are with us in darkness and in light.
Blessed are you who in goodness created both darkness and light, that you might reveal to us the mysteries of faith. Send us out into the world in confidence to proclaim the revelation of your love and the work you are doing in us and through us, for your kingdom come. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you, and also with you. Peace be with you, Nancy. Good morning and welcome. Continue on. Keep greeting. That's okay. I apologize for the sound issues. I just checked in with Sam and Scott. Thank you for your help, but they let me know the technical term for what was going on is Adrienne's mic pack had an unclean spirit. Eric, we're going to keep that. So just pray hard. Just a reminder, we're so grateful to have this new sound system, but things go wrong sometimes. That's all right. I'm going to turn the announcements around just a little bit. First of all, we welcome you. We're glad you're here. If you're joining us in person or online, you'll find information at the base of the pillars or at the top of the website. If you're new, a newcomer card, you can let us know you're here. If anyone is celebrating a birthday or an anniversary, I invite you to come forward now. So that we can celebrate with you. Oh, I recognize somebody. Actually, I'm calling you up. Yeah, you get to say the birthday blessing. I've got you.
Can you hear me on this mic? There we go. Okay. Let us pray. Oh God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, upon your servants Shar and Joe as they begin another year. Grant that they may each grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Okay, lots happening this morning, including we have our usual Sunday Bible study immediately following this. I'll also be doing a Dean's Forum on 5 years at Trinity. So 5 years we've been together, a pretty eventful 5 years, we can say. Look forward to that conversation, so join us. For those of you who have been around for a good long time, you'll recognize, we'll learn a little bit about the last few years. And some of you who are relatively new, you'll get a nice little slice of history. From Trinity from the last few years. So join us for that. This Tuesday, really big Tuesday, we're celebrating 50 years of women's ordination to the priesthood with a showing of the Philadelphia 11 and a forum with one of those first priests. That'll be this coming Tuesday. I hope you've registered for that. If you haven't registered but you still want to go, shoot us an email. It's a big cathedral. I'm sure we can find space. Also, though, GCC is kicking off Battle for Democracy at Elizabeth Baptist Church at 7 p.m. Join us for that. We'll have a GCC contingent going to that. And then, if you still want to see the film, it's showing at St. Peter's Lakewood and St. Paul's in Cleveland Heights, all a part of the same film series, if you will. Next Sunday is our annual meeting, so it'll be after this service at 10 a.m. Please come in order to vote for vestry and nominating committee, as well as some minor bylaw revisions. So you can familiarize yourself with that online. Also, look out for the annual report that'll come out later this week. So we'll have a lot of your information before you come in to the meeting. A week from Saturday, 2 weeks from Saturday, is the Absalom Jones and Barbara Harris celebration. That will be at Church of the Savior in Akron this year. And we're going to start announcing soon, Friday, February 23rd at 7 p.m., Songs of Freedom, Hope, and Peace. That's through the Roots of American Music. Morgan is helping to coordinate that. And that'll also be here at 7 p.m. as the performing artists Sam Hooper and Angela Winborn will be performing gospel protest songs and uplifting anthems from social justice movements in American history, so later in February. Now, today is one of several throughout the year Gratitude Sundays, where we give thanks for the ministry that you all offer to help Trinity to be the place that it is. So I'm going to invite Ginger Bitterkofer and Luke Taylor to come forward. We have prayed, we have laid hands on this microphone that it may work for you. Keep your prayers uplifted. Come on, Ginger.
Good morning. I'm going to read from some prepared notes because I don't want to forget anybody and I don't want to forget anything. So I'm delighted to have the opportunity, though, to give you, our worship volunteers, a shout out today in person. I truly hope that I say thank you to all of you every week, every time, every year, because that's what I strive to do. Because we couldn't do what we do without all of you, offering hospitality to everyone who comes through our doors, which is a lot of people. It's a lot. We couldn't do this without all of you filling the dozens of roles that are needed each week with dedication and love. You know hospitality is my thing, so those of you are all my colleagues, and I'm happy you're with me in the ministry of Trinity Cathedral to this city and to the world. Thank you. Now I'm going to ask each group of volunteers, past and present, so I know some of you are past volunteers, please stay standing as our vestry members come around to give each of you a ribbon, and please hold your applause for all of these fine folks until the end. So first, I'm going to ask our greeters, who welcome everyone with a smile, to stand right now. We're just going to, greeters, anybody who does greeting, good, we got some greeters, I know we do have some. Now, I'm going to ask our online greeters, who can't stand up, but I know there's a few of you out there. I think Sandy Luther is on for this service, who extend hospitality beyond our walls. Thank you. Now, our ushers, please stand, who they offer hospitality and guidance, and also our offering attendants, who assist weekly with the offerings. Now, if we have Flower Guild volunteers here, whose members beautify our worship space to the glory of God. Now I'm going to ask our sacristans, the Altar Guild, to stand, who work mostly behind the scenes to set Christ's table in a fitting manner. Now I'll ask to stand our acolytes, who serve at the altar with solemnity. I think there's some acolytes over here. Maybe even some past and present ones. Mm-hmm. Now, our lectors and intercessors, who thoughtfully prepare their prayers and readings each week. Now stand our Eucharistic ministers, who handle the blood of Christ with care. And if you're not able to stand, just raise your hand, Tony. Now, if we have thurifers among us, those who carry the incense in just the right way, maybe not at this service. And finally, I'll ask to stand our vergers and worshiped assistants who organize it all. Ted, come out. We have some among us. Again, thank you. Now you may applaud.
So as you can see, it takes a village. And it's an invisible village when you come in many ways. Church, we are grateful, are we not? Amen?
Amen.
Say it with me. We are grateful.
We are grateful.
Amen. My name's Luke Taylor. I am a co-chair, along with Sister Becky Fuller, of the Stewardship Committee. You may have first seen me, along with others, delivering ministry moments during our pledge drive this past fall, when we were inviting you to select your pledges for our fiscal year this year. And at that time, I delivered a message to you that, among other things, I was inclined to make my first pledge year before last because of the way that this place blesses me, and it might also bless you in the same way. And that this place has costs of doing business. But the other message that I shared with you was that in addition to monetary ways that we steward a place that is a part of our family, that we are a part of the family. There are non-monetary ways that we are stewards as well. And there were 15 people or more that stood here. There were a dozen or more that stood at 8 a.m. There will be more at 11:15. And as we continue this series throughout the coming months, other types of people who are part of stewarding the life of this place and our family that we have here, there are many ways that we can be a part of stewarding this place. On behalf of the stewardship committee, myself, Sister Becky Fuller, I want to thank you. We are going to be telling the story of stewardship all year round, the many ways that we steward what we have, all of the resources that we have, the way that we give back to one another, and the blessing that we can be to the community that we have and we are honored to be in, deep roots in this neighborhood that we are in. Thank you.
I invite you to walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Blessed be the tide. Give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. All thanks and praise are yours at all times and in all places, our true and loving God. Through Jesus Christ, your eternal word, the wisdom from on high by whom you created all things. You laid the foundations of the world and enclosed the sea when it burst out from the womb. You brought forth all creatures of the earth and gave breath to humankind. Wondrous are you, Holy One of blessing. All you create is a sign of hope for our journey.
And so as the morning stars sing your praises, we join the heavenly beings and all creation as we sing with joy. And honor are yours, creator of all. Your word has never been silent. You called a people to yourself as a light to the nations. You delivered them from bondage and led them to a land of promise. Of your grace, you gave Jesus to be human, to share our life, to proclaim the coming of your holy reign, and give himself for us a fragrant offering. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, you have freed us from sin, brought us into your life, reconciled us to you, and restored us to the glory you intend for us. We thank you that on the night before he died for us, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection and ascension, longing for Christ's coming in glory and presenting to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, we acclaim you, O Christ. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Christ Jesus, come in glory. Send your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be to us the body and blood of your Christ. Grant that we, burning with your Spirit's power, may be a people of hope, justice, and love. Giver of life, draw us together in the body of Christ, and in the fullness of time, gather us with all your people into the joy of our eternal home. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, we worship you, our God and Creator, in voices of unending praise. Blessed are you, now and forever. As Christ teaches us, we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. God of promise, you have prepared a banquet for us. Happy are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. The gifts of God.
For
people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ poured himself out for us. Your shared same mind, the same love in one body.
Oh, Let us pray. God of abundance, you have fed us with the bread of life and cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another, and you have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. May the God who creates life, the Savior who loves life, and the Spirit who is the fire of life bless you and keep you this day and forevermore. Amen.
There is no shadow of turning.
Let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Thanks be to God.